one of the most critical journalistic voices we have on our side to keep an eye on things. He's a George Polk Award winner, and he's a co-founder of The Intercept, and we're so happy to have him back here tonight. Please welcome Jeremy Scahill. Somebody open that back door and yell, please.
Jeremy!
Jeremy!
All right,
here I am. I missed the intro. It's because Glenn Greenwald is out in the lobby on his Tails computer trying to debate whether or not to out a CIA agent. We're really honored to be here with all of you tonight. Well, Glenn's already coming up. You go ahead and sit down, Glenn. Glenn Greenwald. You know, what's kind of funny is that Citizen 4 is playing here tonight, which is a fantastic film I hope all of you have seen by our colleague, Laura Fortress. Glenn was not supposed to speak here tonight. He was here because he wanted to watch himself on camera for the 40th time. But we walked in and people were coming out of Citizen 4, and people were like, wait a minute, are you doing a Citizen 4 event tonight?
And I looked like this jackass who came specifically to like lurk in the lobby of a movie just because the movie I'm in was playing, and I looked like, oh look, I'm here, and that's not actually why I was here, so I went and hid in the corner by the electrical closet.
We're living in a moment right now where there's an incredible amount of news coming out on the stories that I think all of us and many people came here tonight find incredibly important. We had the CIA's torture report come out through the Senate. It's inadequate. It's not complete. It only holds a small part of the U.S. national, what's called the U.S. national security apparatus, accountable. But there's an opening in the dialogue that has occurred. And tonight what we want to do is talk about that report, but also what's not in that report. Mm-hmm. In the context of the issues that we raise tonight in this film. And we're so honored to have Pardiss Kebriaei, who is an incredible freedom fighter in this society. Pardiss is one of the incredible lawyers that has ensured that the prisoners who were abducted from around the world and taken to Guantanamo would have legal representation. We all are in great admiration of the work that our colleagues from the ACLU have done over the years. But when people started to be snatched and taken to Guantanamo, there was a question even among radical lawyers about the legality and the morality of representing those prisoners. And the ACLU now works very closely on those cases, and they deserve a lot of credit. But the first lawyers that came forward and said, we believe these people have a right to legal counsel. We want to make sure that they have a legal defense. We want to make sure that the constitutional questions raised by shipping people to a gulag in an occupied part of Cuba have a right to legal representation. That was the Center for Constitutional Rights. And they deserve a tremendous amount of credit for what they did and what they did in real time. And all of you who have bought tickets tonight are contributing to a fundraiser for the Center for Constitutional Rights. And Glenn and I are very proud to be here with Pardiss and her colleagues from CCR and to thank them for what they've done in defense of democratic principles in this country. We are here at a moment when some parts of the CIA are being held accountable for the torture that they committed. But we are also here at a time when large aspects of the national security apparatus are getting away scot-free. Mm-hmm. Not just parts of the CIA, but parts of the military in general. We have a president in Obama who won the Nobel Peace Prize, who is a constitutional lawyer by training, and is presiding over what is effectively a global assassination campaign. And perhaps the most devastating aspect of this is that President Obama is not just arguing that the US has a right to do this, but that it is right to do this. And if we didn't have journalists like Glenn Greenwald, and we didn't have organizations like the Center for Constitutional Rights, we would be in an epically dark period where there was very little hope. The grand irony of lawyers being freedom fighters in our society is clear, but it's true. And Pardiss is one of those bright lights in the darkness. So we're very honored to have her and Glenn here tonight. And I just want to start this off by opening it up to both Glenn and Pardiss to give their analysis in the big picture of the big takeaways from the release of the Senate's report on CIA torture. So maybe we can start with Pardiss.
Sure. Jeremy, thank you. Thank you both for being here. We actually, you know, as part of Nasser al-Awlaki's legal team, and that was with the ACLU, so I want to credit them with a lot of tremendous work as well. So at CCR, right, we started representing Guantanamo detainees in 2002. We now represent detainees, current and former, who were subjected to some of the methods of torture in the CIA, in the Senate CIA report. Some of them are named in the report. One is a man named Majid Khan. There's been a lot of his name in the press about the report in the past weeks. He is he was a Baltimore resident. He was around 22 years old when he was in secret CIA detention. He, according to the report, was subjected to the euphemistic rectal feeding, which meant that his lunch tray, consisting of hummus, pasta with sauce, raisins, and nuts, was pureed and rectally infused. That is the CIA's language. That's not ours. We can't actually talk about any of the detail of the torture. We know about his treatment. We represent other men who are named in the report who remain detained at Guantanamo without charge. These are men the US government has no intention of charging ever, whom it has held for over 12 years and for whom there is still no plan for release. And then we represent other men who are not named in the report because, as the report says, the CIA did not keep complete or full records, lists, of everyone who went through its detention interrogation program. So in some sites, there were no records at all. So the report is about 119 known detainees, but that is by no means it. But I think when I was sort of watching the film and thinking about the report, I think the critical importance of the report sort of had neon lights around it, because there is so little, not so little information we have about national security programs like the drone program, but so little government information we have, so little authoritative official information we have. Around the targeted killing program still, this is years after President Obama escalated this program, there are, according to credible non-governmental sources like the Bureau of Investigative Journalists, there are over 4,000 people who have been killed in multiple countries outside of battlefields in Pakistan, Somalia, Yemen, and elsewhere. The government has acknowledged and told us the names of exactly five people out of over as many as 4,000 people. We don't have their data. We don't have data about countries where these have occurred. We don't have any data about the individuals. We don't have any of the legal standards, the legal memos that we now know about the torture program by the CIA. We have none of that kind of information about the targeted killing program. So there is this absolute just dearth of government information about things like the drone program, and then here you have this CIA's, this Senate report that is by the Senate committee that was tasked, that is tasked with oversight of the CIA. It's based on 6 million pages of the CIA's own materials. So it leaves a lot out. It is only part of the US torture program under Bush and Obama still. But for what it is, it's critically important, and it has to be used to press for accountability, however you think that should happen. CCR's position is that we're calling for investigation and prosecution. prosecution, for the DOJ to initiate investigations and prosecution is not a policy choice. It's not a matter of looking forward or backward. It is legally required under international treaties that the U.S. has ratified, that Ronald Reagan ratified. The Convention Against Torture requires governments to investigate allegations of torture where there is reasonable, sufficient evidence available. That evidence is absolutely clear when it comes to torture by Bush administration officials with respect to the CIA. If the DOJ does not investigate, which again, there's practically speaking, there's a lot of blood on everyone's hands, and the implications of Obama's DOJ starting an investigation are huge. If they don't, though, other countries have an obligation under international law, under the Convention Against Torture, to investigate and prosecute. And that is required by a provision that, ironically, the U.S. government itself pressed for in ratifying the Convention Against Torture. There's a duty to investigate and prosecute by all members to the Convention Against Torture. The U.S. at one time said, you know, this is an important provision and we should keep it in because states who have a policy of torture are unlikely to want to prosecute their own government officials. So that was the U.S.'s position way back. It's unlikely that the Obama administration is going to prosecute. We're calling for it. But we do think that there is hope that other countries, in Europe in particular, take up investigations. And in fact, yesterday, we and the European Center for Constitutional and Human Rights, based in Berlin, filed a request with the chief prosecutor in Germany to initiate investigations against George Tenet, who is the CIA director under Bush, and Donald Rumsfeld. There is a case pending in the National Court of Spain that is open. It's an open investigation on behalf of a group of Guantanamo detainees who were subjected to torture under Donald Rumsfeld. That case is proceeding. It was actually once assigned to the judge who issued an international arrest warrant for Pinochet in 1998. And at that time, no one involved in that effort thought there was any hope of anything like that happening. Those efforts at the time seemed important, but largely symbolic. So it's things like that, it's experiences like that in history that I think give us hope and are sort of why we're continuing to demand for prosecutions internationally, at least. So.
And I also was remiss in not thanking the IFC Center for doing this tonight, because they didn't have to do this. This would have been a big night for Babadook or one of the other films. I saw Babadook, it's a good horror film. But we're really grateful for that. And I also just want to point out that there are several people here tonight from the Center for Constitutional Rights and also from The Intercept and First Look Media, who are working every day to try to do great investigative journalism and great justice-oriented legal work. So thank you to everyone who's here tonight from both of those organizations. I wanted to ask Glenn Greenwald, who has reported on these issues for many, many years, and if you haven't seen Citizen 4, which is also playing in this theater, you might be able to sneak into the next screening of it, because it's in the same theater. You know, Glenn Greenwald has been an unusual, amazing voice in our society. Glenn is a constitutional lawyer by training, like the president, and has chosen a very different job. Glenn reminds me of Amy Goodman in the sense that whatever Glenn becomes a part of, and this is true of Amy Goodman, he immediately becomes the hardest working person there. He gets up incredibly early. He is scouring the internet, talking to sources, and doing incredible hard-hitting journalism. He was involved in a story from a very early stage involving Edward Snowden and Snowden's documents, where he was confronted with a choice that he knew was going to change his life forever. And he could have ignored that and gone on just blogging, and he would have been fine, and he would have been at The Guardian, or he would have been at Salon. But what Glenn did was that he embraced the risk. He embraced the risk that many reporters understand when they meet incredible people. And I remember when Glenn first told me, before Edward Snowden's name was public, before an article was printed, Glenn told me, the person that I've just met has changed my life forever and changed what I'm going to do forever. And I am going to drop everything in my life and just work on these stories because I want to do justice to the person that's taking these risks to do this thing. And it turned into the Edward Snowden revelations. And you know, I have always viewed Glenn as one of our greatest commentators, journalists, analysts in our society, and one of our epic freedom fighters. And on the torture report, you know, we've had some technical problems with The Intercept about we couldn't do a live blog the other day because our back end wasn't that good yet, and we're gonna fix all of that. But Glenn said, I am going to figure out a way for us to just analyze this thing all day long. And he just did it. He got up at 5 a.m. and just started coordinating coverage on this thing. And he probably has read the Senate report closer than anyone at this point, but also is identifying areas where what we didn't know is going to be exposed, and what we did know is being whitewashed. Or what we did know, the whole truth isn't being told. We were late tonight because we were working on a story that Glenn's going to do tomorrow. Everyone should look at The Intercept. Involving one of the key architects of the torture program. And I think it's incredible that we have Glenn here tonight to talk about this. So I just wanted to not throw you a softball, but give you the space to talk about your initial reading of the torture program, but also maybe talk to people about what they're reading and what's not there, or what they're reading and isn't the whole truth.
Well, first of all, good evening, everyone, and thank you, Jeremy, for those very nice words. And before I address that, I just want to echo what Jeremy said about CCR, because I, as Jeremy said, was before I was a journalist, I was a lawyer, and I was working as a lawyer in the city in 2001 and 2002 as a constitutional lawyer, and it was very obvious to the profession, to the legal profession, that very radical things were taking place very quickly. And one of the duties, in theory, of the legal profession is that it's supposed to, in addition to representing clients for profit, is it's supposed to be this kind of bulwark against incursions into our basic liberties and legal protections. And if you go and look at who was willing in late 2001 and into 2002 and really through 2003 to do that, it was very, very few people. Almost no law firms were willing to touch Guantanamo cases or anybody accused of terrorism charges. Larger institutional groups that generally you would expect to do that were very cautious for understandable reasons that could have threatened their ability to operate, and yet one of the very few groups in the world very early on who took a stand against this in this really unflinching way, at a time when I think we forget the climate was actually really quite repressive, was CCR. And it's easy to look back now and say, you know, Guantanamo litigation, every law firm in the world is willing to do it now because it's pretty conventional. Even through the second term of the Bush administration, when Bush was unpopular and it was obvious what the Iraq War was and the War on Terror, everybody joined that cause, or lots of people did. Back in late 2001 and 2002, people were petrified to speak against the government, and yet the CCR was not just doing that, but doing that very aggressively and steadfastly and bravely. And we need those kind of organizations who, especially in times of crisis and greatest danger, rush headlong into that risk in order to take a stand for what they know is right. So I've actually been in New York all week. I'm going on my first vacation in like 2 years tomorrow, so I didn't actually want to do an event, but it's only because this was for CCR that I decided to do it, and I'm really honored to be a part of what all of you work with. So thank you. So I just want to address a couple of brief issues about the torture report and some of the things Jeremy asked about. You just saw Dirty Wars, and I have said for, you know, years, like 2 or 3 years since I saw it for the first time, I guess a year and a half, 2 years now, that I genuinely consider it to be one of the most important political films of our generation. And the reason for that is very specific, which is if you look at how the War on Terror has been waged and sustained, How is it that all of these things that previously were considered not just radical, but just unimaginable, at least in terms of what the mythology of the United States is, how have these things been implemented with so little reaction and so little protest and so little media attention? There are lots of reasons, but for me, the principal reason is that the victims of these abuses have been rendered invisible and therefore completely dehumanized. It's really easy to justify all sorts of injustices if you never have to confront the humanity of the people who are being destroyed. And one of the things that Dirty Wars did, I think, better than probably any work of the War on Terror, is put a human face on the people whose lives have been destroyed by these policies. I mean, I think it's almost impossible, if you're a decent human being, to sit through the scenes of Abdulrahman Awaki's grandparents mourning his death and not be incredibly emotional. And that emotion, I think, is based in the realization, which even those of us who work on these issues, I think, sometimes easily forget, that these are real human beings experiencing profound grief over the way in which our government is destroying their lives. And I really believe that if that realization were more visceral in the American population, that the support for these policies would be gutted, subverted, maybe even entirely eliminated. And that's why Dirty Wars is so potent. And if you look at the way in which we've debated the torture report since it's been released, the most extraordinary thing to me is you can turn on, if you make the mistake of doing so, any of the cable news programs like MSNBC or CNN or Fox News, and you should try to do that as little as possible. But if you're like a captive and you're passing through an airport or whatever and you're subjected to it involuntarily, you're gonna see, I can almost guarantee you, at some point, even if you just watch 15 minutes, actual war criminals, American torturers, being on the screen, talking about what they did, why they did it, not just justifying it, being treated with great respect and reverence. What you will never see or hear are the victims of their torture. Even though there are hundreds, thousands of them all over the world, there are organizations like CCR that represent them. Any television booker could instantly get one of them by simply calling up Patrice or anybody at the ACLU or Reprieve or Cage and saying, we want to interview a torture victim and hear from them what it was like to be subjected to this regimen. You won't hear from them precisely because it is so powerful. It's too illuminating and too enlightening about what our government did. And this has wildly distorted the discourse. Those people remain invisible. Therefore, we can think of it as an abstraction, like we do with the way we kill innocent people with drones or render them to the worst governments or put them in cages in the middle of an ocean. And that dehumanization process has been critical to everything that has been done. And Dirty Wars is an incredible antidote to that, but you see it continuing with the reaction to the torture report. The other point I just want to make really quickly is, it's been bizarre, I think, a bizarre 2 weeks to watch people react to the torture report, because there's this premise among all these establishment media people and even the political class in D.C., like, oh my God, like, wait, we tortured? I never knew that. And had I known this, I would have been disgusted and outraged. And the reality is that for over a decade, the entire political and media class knew that the CIA was torturing not just by waterboarding three people, but by implementing a systematic regime of torture all over the world. And I think it's really important not to accept this myth that the CIA is this rogue agency off doing these horrible things because it's just a bad apple and it needs to be reformed so that it's in line with our values, or that Dick Cheney is some sociopathic monster that's an aberration from American values. Of course he is a sociopathic monster, but he's not an aberration from American values. The CIA is what it is because that is what the political and media class want it to be. They don't want to have their noses rubbed in what it is they're doing, but they want it to be doing exactly what they're doing. And the only thing that changed this week is that we did have our noses rubbed in it, and there's a lot of feigned shock and horror over what it is that they've done. But I think it's important to recognize how consistent with American values it actually is and not a violation of it. And that to me has been the big takeaway from the report.
Exactly.